Masechet Sukkah, daf 53. We're going to be discussing the Mishnah that has all the details of Simchat Bet HaShoeva, and we'll go into lots of description of all the acrobatics and gymnastic tricks that the rabbis used to do. So it's a lot of fun. So we read Veloya Chaser Birushalayim, because of the tall towers with the lanterns on top that had so much oil, there was not a courtyard in Jerusalem that wasn't illuminated from those lights from the Beit HaMikdash. So for a further description, Tana, Isha ita boreret chitim le'or shel Beit HaShoeva, that a woman could sort wheat and take, you know, the good wheat from any impurities that fell into it, you know, like checking the rice. And that requires a lot of light. You have to see exactly what is that. Is that a piece of wheat or is it something else? And so that's how, it wasn't just a little bit light, it was so bright that people could do that at home. Next, Chasidim v'anshei ma'aseh, the pious man, the people of good deeds, they would be dancing before everyone while they were singing praises. So now we're going to learn some of the words that they said in their songs. Tenor banan yesh mehen omrim ashrei yeladutenu shelo biyesha et ziknutenu elu chasidim v'anshei ma'aseh. Some said, happy is our youth, that didn't embarrass our old age. In other words, even when we were young, we were careful with the mitzvot and observant. And so we have, you know, these are chassidim that they were always, they grew up in a religious household. And so they were always good. And therefore, they're not embarrassed about their past. Other people, when they grew up, they were wise guys, and they weren't always doing the right thing. But then they made teshuvah later in life. So they sing, they sing lyrics that said, "Happy is our old age that atones for our sins." So recognizing once upon a time, what could we do? But at least now we're better. And they agreed on the following lyrics that happy is the person that never sinned, but if you did, then make teshuvah and you can get atonement. Maybe it was the same song. Maybe it was like one would say one stanza, the other group would say the other stanza, and then they would join together with that stanza to show, you know, we're all, whatever our backgrounds are, everyone can reach the same level. Tanya. Amiru alav alidel azaken kishay asamech besimchat Bet HaShoeva amar ken im ani kan hakol kan im ani kan mikan. So Hillel, he lived during the time of the Beit HaMikdash in early first century, and when he would come to sing and dance in Simchat Bet HaShoeva, he would say, sing the following: if I'm here, everyone's here, and if I'm not here, who's here? Okay, so it sounds a little bit egotistical, right? Oh, very good. So how do we interpret this? What does he mean? If I'm here, everyone's here. I'm the life of the party, right? What is he trying to say? So some interpret it as for he's quoting Hashem. Hashem saying, if I am here in the Beit HaMikdash, then everything's here. But if you act in a way that I don't want to be here, then what do you know? Then nobody's here. Then everything is for naught. So that's a possibility. Or he might be saying, similar to his other statement, now if I'm here, I have to feel responsible for myself and for others. And if I'm not going to be responsible, then who's going to take care of what needs to be done? And so this could be a play on that. Hu haya omer ken, makom sheni ohev, sham raglai molichot oti. Im tavo el beti, ani avo el betecha. If im ata lo tavo el beti, ani lo avo el betecha. Shenemar bechol ha-makom asher azkir et shemi, avo elecha uberachticha. So Hillel also used to say that to a place where I love to be, my legs take me there automatically. Right, I just gravitate towards holiness, and so you know it's like destined that of course I'm going to be here. Where else would I be? My legs just bring me here. And furthermore, and this is for sure quoting Hashem, saying, Hashem says, if you come to my house, if you come to the Beit HaMikdash and enjoy and celebrate, I will also come to your house. Hashem will visit a person's individual house and bring him blessing there. If you don't come to my house and you don't care about all the service and the celebration here, then why should I come visit you? You didn't come visit me. And how do we learn this? From the pasuk that says, in any place that I mention my name, I will come and bless you. Now in the Peshat, this is talking about when you had a Mishkan and it moves around. So any place that you set up the Mishkan and you call upon Hashem, Hashem will be there. It might be in Shiloh one day, it might be somewhere else. But I think that later on, when it becomes only in Jerusalem, one set place, so then what does this mean, any place? So any place means even your house, right? As long as you come and mention my name in my house, I will come to your house and give you blessing. That's a nice way of giving a parallel between the Beit HaMikdash and one's, the holiness of one's own home. There's a famous quote from Pirkei Avot that Hillel also said the following. One time he was passing by the water and he saw a skull floating in the water. And he said, talking to the skull, Amar la, al de ateft atfuch umetifayich yitufun. So the root is drowning, but in all different, this is, you could do a whole grammar lesson on the different forms of the verb here. So because you drowned others, he knew the guy, there's some kind of thug, some mafia boss. I know you were a murderer, used to go drown people. So you got what was coming to you, and you were drowned in turn. And those people who drowned you, that maybe the other mafia family, they'll also be drowned. What comes around, goes around, right? You get what you deserve. And right, exactly. Amida keneged mida. So Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Raglohi debar inish, inun arbin be, le'atar de'mit ba'e taman, mobilin yate. This is similar to the previous statement that Hillel said, my legs bring me here automatically. Rabbi Yochanan says, the feet of a person are arevin, they're responsible for him, and to the place where he is needed, they take him. Sometimes even it's like fated that you're going to be here, so your legs have a mind of their own, and you end up being there, whether you like it or not. And the next story is going to be an actual application of this, of someone who's trying to get away from his fated death, and ends up in the place anyway, where they are killed. So here's the story. So there were two kushim that served before Shlomo. And so they were with him in the palace. Rashi says this is a way of saying these were two very good-looking people. Soferim di Shlomo havu. So they were the scribes of Shlomo. That was their job. Now, yom achad haziem alach hamavet hava ka'aseb. One day, King Shlomo saw the angel of death, and he was sad. Amaleh amay asibat. I don't know if it's ever a good idea to start a conversation with the angel of death, right? I don't want to know. But he says, so angel of death, why are you sad? Because I have a script that I have to come and attend, arrest and take the two Kushites that are working for you. And I'm having a hard time getting them. I'm trying to catch them. I can't catch them. And so that's why I'm sad. I can't do my job. It's time for them to die. So Shlomo said, oh, interesting. Okay, then Shlomo goes, he wants to save their lives. So Shlomo, he knew how to control the demons. Strangely, Shlomo knows how to control the demons, but the angel of death, he doesn't. So anyway, he gets these demons to say, listen, take these two kushim and you got to hide them away. Malach HaMavet is after them. Send them to the village of Luz. You know what you call people that come from Luz, right? Losers. Okay, Luz was known to be a city of refuge that, you know, if you go there, you're safe. So he said, okay, I'll send them there and they'll be safe. The second they get to the city, they died immediately when they entered the city. The next day, King Shlomo sees the angel of death and he's smiling and laughing. Why are you laughing? He says, I got you. And the place where I had to arrest them, that's where you sent them. Right? It was all a setup. I was making believe I was sad. So then I set you up to say, I'm going to save them. I knew you would send them to Luz, and that's where I needed them to be. I didn't have the power to kill them until they got to Luz. So actually you helped me. Miyad patach Shlomo v'amar, ragloi devar inish, inun arbin be, atadmit ba'et aman, mobilin yate. Right, so he quoted what we said above, in the name of Rabbi Yochanan, that the legs of a person are his, are responsible for him, and he's going to end up in the place that they lead him, whether they like he likes it or not. Okay, this is a typical story about fate, you know, like in lots of legends and stories, someone says, you know, this is going to be your fate, and you try to get out of it, and whatever you do, that actually ends up leading you to the very destiny that he was trying to avoid. Okay, Tanya, Amiru alav araban Shimon ben Gamliel. Okay, so that was a tangent. We were talking about some of the lyrics that the rabbi said, and then we went off to different things that Hillel said, but now we're coming back. As I said, regarding Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel, kishya sameh simchat bet ha-shuva, haya notel shemone avukot shel or bezorek achat, venotel achat, venogeot zo bazo. Lashpag, he was able to take 8 torches, throw one up and catch another one, and no two ever touched each other. In other words, he's juggling 8 torches of fire. וכשהו משתחווה נועס שני גודליו בארץ ושוחה, ונושק את הרספה וזוקף. Ve'en kol b'riya yechola la'asot ken, v'zohi kida. He also did this gymnastic feat that he was able to prostrate himself, go from standing all the way to lying down, only with his gudalav. I think that means his toes. It could mean thumbs also. I'll explain both ways. If it means his toes, like just his toes are, he stuck them in the ground and he was able to stick them so strongly and his ankles were very strong, he was able to go all the way down and kiss the ground and come up without using any other part of his body. And no one else could do that. This is, by the way, Kida, when the Kohen Gadol had to prostrate himself. He knew how to do this and no one else knew how to do it. This was like a special technique. But he performed this for Simchat Bet HaShoeva. Lehavdil, Elef Alfei Elef Dalot, Michael Jackson had a famous move when the dancers, they sway very low, like against the laws of gravity. You can't possibly balance yourself in that way. So later on, they found out his trick, that he had a clip on the bottom of his shoe that clipped into the stage. And so it held his foot in place, and then he was able to lean all the way. He didn't go all the way down, but he had one of the secrets of Kida. Okay, again, the Havdil. Right, he did, exactly. So that's another trick he did. Another interpretation is that he used his thumbs. It was like push-ups just with your thumbs, which would sound a little bit easier. Good. Levi achvi kida kamed rebi ve'itla. One time, the Amora named Levi, he demonstrated how to do kida in front of Rebi Yehuda Hanasi, and he became lame. He pulled something in his ankle, and he could never walk again. So this is really dangerous. Don't try this at home. Hold on. Is that why he became lame? We have another story that also about how he became lame. So he couldn't have become lame twice. Le'olam al yatiach adam devarim kelepe ma'ala. Sharei adam gadol yatiach devarim kepi ma'ala. Ve'itla umanu levi. And the answer is ha ve'ha garmele. Okay, so we have a statement that you should never throw things up to heaven, meaning insults. You shouldn't complain to heaven and say, no, Hashem, you're not just, and say you're unfair. Don't say insulting things towards God. And one great sage once did that, and as a punishment, he became lame. And who was that? Levi. One time there was no rain, and he said, Hashem, you're unfair, how could you do this? And he was punished. So now we have two different stories. So how did he become lame? Because he tried the kida, or because he said disrespectful things in his prayer? So the answer is both caused it. First he did this improper prayer, and he deserved some punishment, and then he put himself into a dangerous situation, and that was the straw that broke the camel's back. One without the other, he wouldn't have, but both together. That's now back to the acrobatics. Levi would walk in front of the Biudanasi, so another thing before the Biudanasi, and he would be juggling 8 knives. Good. Now, the Biudanasi is living already after the Bet HaMikdash is destroyed. So we're not talking about Simchat Bet HaShoeva. This is just, maybe it was on Sukkot, just for fun, or whatever reason. Some people give an allegorical explanation. Biudanasi, he had to deal with the Roman government and the people and the judges and the taxes. So it's like sometimes it feels like juggling knives to be in a place of leadership. You got to juggle all the different interests.
Levi
was doing it in front of Levi, like to console him, like, you know, this is what you have to do.
Shemuel kameh teshevor malka betamnia mazge hamra.
Shemuel would juggle in front of King Shapur with 8 wine glasses, I guess, full of wine. So King Shapur was the king of the Persian Sassanid Empire, very, very important and powerful person. And he was known to be tolerant. And, you know, in the Persian Empire, all religions and people were welcome to do their thing. And he had a close relationship with Shemuel. There's lots of stories about that. King Shapur tells Shemuel, I hear that you Jews are so smart. Tell me what I'm going to dream about tonight. In Berachot, right? And he says, oh, you're going to dream that the Romans are going to catch you and chain you in golden chains, and you're going to be digging the earth. And so he's so bothered by that all day, because that was his enemy, Rome. And so he's thinking about it all day, and sure enough, he dreams about it at night. But that's because he was thinking about it all day. So anyway, Shemuel was smart. He knew how to convince Shapur that he was so smart. Good. So that's another thing he did before, in front of the king. Again, not related to Simchat Bet HaShoava. This is just for a foreign king. But since we're mentioning acrobatic tricks, we can mention, you know, Rabbi Sammy doing the cigarette trick, right?
Abaye kameh derava betamnaya be'ae.
Abaye would juggle 8 eggs in front of Rava. Others say, no, it wasn't 8, it was only 4. Okay, I like that line, like, oh, come on, don't exaggerate. He wasn't doing 8. It's yiridat hadorot, right? Then they weren't able to do. Okay, I think I could do 1. Tanya.
Amar bi Yoshua ben Hananya, kesheinu semechim semichat bet haShoava, lo ra'inu shena be'aynenu.
So he says, Rabbi Yoshua says, we never slept for 7 days because we're busy all night, and we were celebrating all day, celebrating all night, and we're busy with other things all day. Here was our schedule, kesad. Sha'ari shona tamid shel shachar. In the morning, you have to take care of the tamid. He was a Levi, so he was singing, he was playing instruments. Misham la tefillah. Then we have to go pray. They even had prayer, right? The Mishnah in Tamid says, they said, Aseret HaDibarot. This is all the things that they said. Not Amidah, because they had Korbanot, but they said other things. Misham le Korban Musaf. Then do Musaf. Misham le Tefillat HaMusafin. And then they say the prayers that relate to the Musaf. Misham le Bet HaMidrash. Then we have to go study in the Bet HaMidrash. Misham le Achila V'Shtuyah. Then we go for lunch. Misham le tefillat hamincha, come back from mincha. Misham le tamid shel ha'arbayim, right? In the afternoon, a daily sacrifice. Mikan ve'elach b'simchat bet haShoava. By that time, it's late afternoon, and we start with the celebration, and we do that all night. Good. Ini, hold on, we have a contradiction. V'amar Rabbi Yochanan sheboa shelo ishan shelosha yamim malkin oto v'yashen le'altar. If someone would make a swear and say, I swear I'm not going to sleep for the next 3 days. That's impossible, right? No one can possibly do that. I mean, you know, they use this for torture to get people to talk. Right? Your body automatically will fall asleep. You could ask doctors that try to do this. It's a false oath. So even the second I make the oath, we already whip you for making a false oath, because we know we're not even going to wait 3 days. We know there's no way you're going to fulfill it, and you may as well go to sleep right now because you already broke the oath, right? It's already, you know you're going to break it, so you may as well do it from now. And so therefore, this is the question is, how could you say you never slept? You stayed up for 7 days and 7 nights. You can't even sleep for 3 days. Okay, the first truth is that they didn't do all the celebration on Shabbat and Yom Tov. Nevertheless, there's going to be 3 days in there, so we don't believe you. Ella hachika amar lo ta'amnu tam shena davo minamne akatefa dehadadeh. The answer is we didn't. I have a taste of total sleep, right? But we did take doze and take quick naps on each other's shoulders. During the dancing, we would just rest for a little, but we never had a full sleep. We didn't go to bed. That's what I meant. But yeah, we took a little naps. Now, next, Chamesh Esre Ma'alot. There were 15 stairs in going from the courtyard out Shah Nikanor, down 15 stairs till you get to Zrat Nashim, and so where the partying was. And so the Kohanim would start on top, they would blow the Hasosrot, and then they would go down, assist, and then to the 10th stair and blow again. And when they got to the floor, they would blow again, and they would continue blowing the whole way. So question, Amar le Rav Chisda da Ahuvin de Rabbanan, da have kam sader agadeta kameh,
אמר לה, שמי הלך הנה 15 מעלות, כנגד מי אמרם דוד.
So, okay, the Mishnah mentioned the 15 steps, right? And we associated that with the 15 Shira Ma'alot in Tehillim, right? So there's one for each. But now, forget that a second. Now this is an independent story. Rav Chista spoke to the sage who was an expert in Agadah. Some rabbis were experts in Agadah. They would make derashot, and others were experts in Halakha. And the ones that knew Agadah, because they were experts, Rav Chista said, you have to remind me of the Agadah I once heard, but I forgot what it is. The question is, the 15 Shira Ma'alot in Tehillim, what do they correspond to? Why are there 15 Shira Ma'alot? Okay, he doesn't answer that. It's the 15 steps. This is a totally separate Agadah. Amar lehachi amar Rabbi Yochanan b'shash shekara David shitin, kafa tehoma ube'i lemishtefa alma. When David was digging drain pipes under the Mizbeach for Simchat Bet Hashem. Remember there was an opinion that said they were vats underneath were there from the time of creation. Another opinion says, no, they were dug. Right. So this says David was digging them. He wasn't able to build the Bet HaMikdash, but he prepared as much as he could. And when he did that, he unplugged something that shouldn't have been unplugged, and the deep waters from before creation that Hashem separated the waters above and below and said, okay, you stay here. They wanted to come up and flood the whole world. This is related to a lot of, in the Mabul, right? The waters underneath come up. Other Midrashim that talk about how the waters below, they want to keep coming up. They feel they still have a grudge that they were put down there. This idea of people live through floods all the time. I mean, we had one right here a few years ago that the waters are dangerous and they're always trying to come up. Okay, so this is like a story when David unplugged this thing, and now this was very bad. Amar David chameshesre ma'alot v'horidan. So David prayed these 15 shira ma'alot, and then the water receded. So now question on that. Iyachi chameshesre ma'alot. Rav Chista tells this master of Agadah, you're such a master of Agadah, this doesn't make any sense. He should have said, Shir ha-yeridot, right? Not Shir ha-ma'alot, you're making the water go up. There's something missing in your story. He says, Amar le, hoil ve'ad karatan mileta, hachit. Rav Chista says, but thank you for reminding me of the story. Now I remember the rest of it, right? And so now he's going to fill in the full extent of the story. Amarle, it's not really clear who says to whom. Maybe the Pa'al Agadah says, oh, you're right, it's a good question. Now I remember the rest of it. Okay, whoever said it, this is what it means. This is what Rabbi Yochanan, when he quoted it, meant to say. When David was digging out the drain pipes, so then the deep waters threatened to flood the whole world. David says, the only way I'm going to get them down is to write Hashem's name on a piece of earthenware and throw it in, and the earthenware is heavy, it'll go down, and that will calm the water. We need a miracle, and we need Hashem's name written on this in order to make that happen. The problem is that if you write Hashem's name in ink on an earthenware shard and put it in the water, it's going to be erased. And so I'm setting it up that it will be erased. So am I allowed to write it in the first place? But that's the only solution he knows. So Lekadeh Kamar Lemidi, David asked the rabbis there, and nobody had an answer for him. David, anyone who has an answer and doesn't tell me, he's going to be strangled. Okay, so now all of his advisors are bifledged. Nasa Achitofel Kalvachomer Beasmo. Umala Sot Shalom Ben Ishli Ishto Amra Torah Shemisha Nichta Bikdusha. Yimache Al Hamayim La Sot Shalom Nechol Alam Kolo Alachat Kama Vechama. Amar Leshare. So Achitofel, thinking quick on his feet, said Kalvachomer, for the case, in the case of Sota, when the man suspects the woman, suspects his wife, and he's not sure. So Hashem said, write down Parashat Sota and erase it into ink, and includes Hashem's name. So Hashem said, I don't mind. I forego my honor. You can erase my name in order to bring peace between a husband and wife. So if that's just for one family, all the more so to save the whole world. And so therefore, Achitofel says, it is permitted.
Good. Chatam Shem, Katab Shem Achaspa. David was convinced, and he did. He wrote Hashem's name. Ushte leTomah. He threw it into the water. Benachet Tomah Shitzad Alfei Garmidi. And it worked so well that it went all the way down 16,000 amot. You have to be careful what you wish for. So now he said, this is not good. They went down so much that the soil is not going to be fertile. You need that underground water, the aquifers, in order to keep the roots of the trees moist. So now it went down too far. Now we're going to die of thirst. So he said the 15 should have ma'alot, each one was 1,000, and it was 16,000 low, so now 15,000 higher, now it's only 1,000 below the level of the earth. Good. So he says, we learned from here, that the thickness of the earth is 1,000 amot. There's a layer of earth, and then there's water underneath. I don't know how they thought of it, you know, what it's standing on, the floating, whatever. But they knew that there's water under the ground because you dig wells and there's water down there. Hold on, 1,000 amot, 1,500 feet down, we dig wells and you know, we go 100 feet and we find water. You don't have to go that far. No, that is because you're digging near the Euphrates River and that is high. So it lifts up the waters that are under the ground that are in that area. And so that's why, but generally it's 1,000 amot deep. Okay, great story. And now we get back to the Mishnah. The two Kohanim with the trumpets, they would stand at the upper gate, the Sha'a Nikanor, and then they would blow and then they would go down to the 10th step. So question 10th, what do you mean by 10th? Lemala asirit denachet chamisha vekae asara, or dilma denachet asara vekae chamisha. So does this mean that he would go down 5 stairs and he's on the 10th stair from the bottom and they would blow? Or he went down 10 stairs and so he was 5 of them from the bottom and that's when they would blow? Teko, we're not sure what this means, right? He stopped somewhere in the middle. Okay, the next part of it is that now they're walking out, this whole procession of the Kohanim and everybody, they're going out the gate to the east, right? So their backs are towards the Hechal, and they're going to go all the way out to the river. They're going to get the water, and then they're going to march back. But at that point, it looks like they're disrespecting the Hechal, right? Because their backs are towards the Hechal, they're leaving. And so it looks like they're worshiping the sun. And that's why the Mishnah says that they quote Yechezkel saying, our forefathers, they worshiped the sun to the east and they had their backs. We're not doing that, right? We turn to Hashem and we're going out to do this, but we'll be right back. Good. So now, and they quote the Pasuk. How come in the Pasuk in Yechezkel it says a double language? Their faces are to the east and their back was to Echal. If I know one, tell me one and I know the other. It means they did an extra disgusting thing that they would expose their backsides and defecate towards the Hechal. In other words, it's not bad enough that you're worshiping the sun and doing Avodah Zarah. You're also adding extra insult to the sin by desecrating the Hechal. Okay. Anu leya ulya einenu. And so then they stop there and they say, no, our forefathers worshipped idolatry, but to us, we are for Hashem, and to Hashem is our eyes. We look towards you. Now the question is about this double language. Ini ha'amar bizera kol ha'omer shema shema kiilu omer modim modim. There's a Mishnah, right? That says someone who says modim modim. Chazana says that we open the trap door. We get rid of that guy. Why? Because he shows he's a dualist. He's thanking the God of the good and the God of the bad.
And we don't believe that. And there were many dualists back then, and they, you know, they would make themselves chazan, and they would make believe like they're stuttering. And so, but they weren't. So, and same thing with Shema. You can't say Shema twice. If you notice anytime, like in Selichot or on Yom Kippur, when we say Hashem, you know, Hashem Melech, we say that twice. But Shema, we only say once, right? You're not allowed to say it twice because it sounds like you're referring to two different deities. This is the same thing. If you're saying Anu, Leya, Ulya, Anenu, what? There's two different, right? Why? How come that's allowed? El hachi amre, hemma mishtachavim kedma, ve'anu liya anu modim, anachnu modim, ve'anenu liya miachalot. No, what they meant, the two are in different contexts. So first they're saying, we, to God, we bow, and also our eyes turn towards you. So they're two different contexts. Since they're two different things, it's okay. They're not repeating the same exact words. They're two ideas that are meant consecutively. So therefore, that's permitted.
How do we get away with Adonai Hu Ha'elohim, Adonai Hu Ha'elohim? And we do it twice.
And we do it seven times.
Yeah,
I guess that is really more a statement of absolute monotheism. He is the only God, so maybe it's harder to mistake that for a sense of dualism. Yeah, Mark, you have a question?
Yeah, the previous paragraph about like turning your back toward the Techel, like who is it talking about? Is that talking about the people that are getting the water, or is that the people in the past? Who is that referring to?
People in the past, during the time of Yechezkel. Yes, Yechezkel says, I was transported to Jerusalem and I saw 25 men that were had their backs
on purpose,
right? They were purposely disrespecting and they were worshiping the sun. This, by the way, explains the whole architecture of the Bet HaMikdash, that it purposely faces west. I mean, right, when we go to the Kotel, we're facing east because we're on the other side. So it happens to be we're facing east, but in the Kotel, they'd be facing west for that very reason.
But why would they need to go an extra step, even by turning their back to the Hechal? And they're making a point of saying, our forefathers used to worship the sun, but now we don't. We're just going to get the water and come back. So why would they do the extra step? It doesn't make sense.
The extra step of what? They're making a declaration that says it might look like, right, if someone just took a snapshot, it might look like they are worshiping the sun by going to the east. They do it in the morning early, just when the sun rises. And it's not nice, even today when you leave Bet Knesset, right, you turn around, you walk out backwards, you want to have your face towards. So they don't want to be mistaken for doing that, and so therefore they make this declaration. Okay, next Mishnah. En pochatin me'asrim v'achat tikiot ba mikdash ben mosifin al arba'im u'shmone. This is talking about trumpets, and trumpets were played every day, and depending on what was happening, you never would have less than 21 blasts. And never more than 48. Those are the extremes. Let's count them. Bechol yom hayu sham 21 tikiot b'mikdash. On a regular weekday with no special holiday, they would blow the trumpets 21 times. Shalosh lepetichat she'arim. There's always come in sets of threes because you always do tikiah, teruah, tikiah. Right? You always have long, short, long, no matter what. So one set of blasts, which is three, would be in the morning when they open the gates. While they're doing the Korban Tamid, the Levim are singing, and there's three breaks in the song that they're singing, and there's trumpet playing each time, so that's another nine. In the afternoon, another nine, so that's 21. Musafin, that's 21. Good, that's the minimum. Musafin, ayu musafin, o tesha, on Shabbat, or Rosh Chodesh. Whenever there's Musaf, you have another nine during the Korban Musaf. Ubeerev Shabbat hayu mosifin shesh, shalosh lehavdil et ha'am emilacha, veshalosh lehavdil ben kodesh lechol. So on Shabbat you'd have another six because incoming Shabbat they would blow three times to say Shabbat is starting. Like today, you have the siren in Borough Park in Israel also, and we have that. The Gemara actually explains that they were separated, not all at once. If you have one, say, come in from the field. Now, second time, close your stores. Third time, get all the food where it needs to be. And then again, three times that Shabbat is over. Now, Erev Shabbat, Shebach Tochachag, Ne'a Hayu Sham 48. You have the most when it is Shabbat, Holamoed, during the holiday.
Now you have shalosh b'tichat she'arim, three to open the gates. Shalosh ha'shad ha'elyon, v'shalosh ha'shad ha'tachton, and another three for the higher gate, another three for the lower gate. Each gate that they're passing through, they would do another one. So that's nine. V'shalosh l'milui ha'mayim, v'shalosh al gabei mizbeach. When they go to the river and draw the water, they blow the trumpets. When they bring it back and pour it on the mizbeach, they blow the trumpets. Tesha l'tmin shel shachar, tesha l'tmin shel ben arba'im, tesha l'musafin, shalosh l'abtil l'tamei melacha, v'shalosh l'abtil ben kodesh l'chol. All the rest of them is what you would do on a regular Shabbat or Yom Tov, and that equals 48. Okay, great. Now we're going to analyze this further, and this is going to be relevant for Rosh Hashanah also when we blow the shofar, but we use the same system. Matnitin de lo k'Rabbi Yehuda. Our Mishnah must not be authored by Rabbi Yehuda, the fourth generation, Rabbi Yehuda bar Eli. De Tanya, Rabbi Yehuda omer, ha-pochet lo yifchot me-sheva, ha-moshif lo yosif al-sheshesre. He says the minimum number of tikiot is 7, and the max is 16. So that's much less than our Mishnah. So b'maykami palgez, so what's the essence of their controversy? Rabbi Yehuda sabar tikiya teruah tikiya achati. Rabbanan sabre tikiya lechud uturah lechud. Actually, they're not arguing. They just count in different systems. Rabbi Yehuda considers that the tripartite, tikiya teruah tikiya, he calls that all one. He considers that to be one unit. And Rabbanan, they count that as three. And so he's Rabbi Yehuda who says 7 times 3 is 21, and 16 times 3 is 48. So actually, they're in total agreement, just the way they count it. So more than the way they count it, is it considered one integral unit, or is it three separate things that you happen to always have make that kind of sandwich? Good. So that's now, what's the source for each side? So we're learning this from the paragraph about chasoserot in Parashat Bahalotecha for different things. If you go on a war, you do short ones. When the peace, you do long. When you're going to gather, when you're going to travel, when you're landing. So we're going to focus on three pesukim within there. I'll just read the pesukim first because we're going to keep quoting them. Utkatem teruah. So you see, this is a confusing phrase. You should do this tikiyah in a verb form. You should blow a teruah. So even though it's the word is even though we're doing a teruah, short blasts, it still uses the verb lit utkatem. So utkatem really has two meanings. It can mean a long blast, that's the specific meaning, or it can mean just to blow whatever you are blowing. So anyway, when you do the short ones, then v'nasu machane achonim kedma, then you should travel. Utkatem teruah. So now, right, shenit, when you do a second one, second short blows, and then the ones in the back, they will know, okay, it's time for them to start marching. And that's the summary of the blasts when you are moving. Now, next topic, when you're going to gather everybody together, then blow a tikiah and don't tariu, not a tiruah. Okay, so that's the three pesukim that we're going to be analyzing. So here's Rabbi Yehuda's proof. Utkatem teruah, uchtiv teruah yitkeu. Hakesad tikiah utruah achati. Since the Torah uses the verb utkatem to describe a teruah, you see that they're all the same. They're overlapping words, right? And I could use one word, tikiah, to describe both types of sounds, and therefore it's considered one unit. Exactly. Rabbanan, or Rabbanan, what are you going to do with that pasuk? No, I learned from there the halacha that whenever you're saying doing a tiruah, you have to sandwich it between a tikiah before and a tikiah after. And we see that from the order of the words. First is utkatem tiruah. That means blow a tikiah and then the tiruah. See, for Rabbanan, they think utkatem always means a long one. Utkatem, a long one, and then a short blast. And the next pasuk says, tiruah yitkau. That shows that every time you say have a tiruah, you have to have a tikiah after. And this is the source of how halacha. We always do that. We always make it a sandwich. Good. V'Rabbi Yehuda, v'fanu l'achare minale. So Rabbi Yehuda, you said they're all one. So, but you agree that we make a sandwich. How do you learn that? Nafkale mi shenit.
Oh, later on, it says, Pasuk 6, it says, Utkatem Tiroa Shenit. You should do this again. So what do you mean? What's again? Yep. Meaning you repeat whatever you did. You know, you have a envelope formula, Tikiya Tiroa Tikiya. But Rabbanan, okay, good. Rabbanan my tamayo. Rabbanan successfully rejected the Biuda, but was their source that you should count them as three. From the last pasuk, when you want to gather together for a big meeting, so you do tiki'ah and not tiru'ah. Visa kada tech tiki'ah tiru'ah chati, amalachamana palgada misva'abed, upalgada la'abed. If you think the word titke'u, that one word means three, so then you're saying, do tiki'ah, that means three, but don't do tiru'ah. What are you, it's just confusing. Hashem is saying, do half, but don't do the other half. If it's all integrated, how can I separate them? It's a good point. Rabbi Yehuda says, that's just a signal. It's not a mitzvah, right? When you're talking about doing it with Simchat Bet HaShoeva, or for a Korban, or for Rosh Hashanah, that is a specific mitzvah. Then I have to follow the protocol of Tikiyah, Tiruah, Tikiyah. That's all one. Here it's just saying, if you want to call people, you get someone's attention, so you whistle, right? It's not a technical halakha, and that's why, yes, it's okay to say, do only one without the other. V'rabanan, wouldn't you agree that this is a signal? Yeah, I say yes. Simanahu, v'rachamana shev yamisva. It does work as a signal, but the Torah turns it into a mitzvah. When you're going to make a signal, don't just make up your own system, do it this way, and therefore you have to do it in an official way, tikiyah, tiruah, tikiyah. Keman azla, except that in that case you don't do the tiruah, but still you have to do it as a mitzvah formula. Since it's a mitzvah formula, therefore I can't agree with you that you'd only do half. It must be that each one is separate, and that's why it makes sense for Torah to say do tikiyah when you're gathering people and not tiruah, because I can separate them even in the context of a mitzvah. Good. Now, Keman azla hadamar Rav Kahana. Rav Kahana said the following statement. We want to know who would he follow, Rabbi Yehuda or Rabbanan? He said, "En ben tikiyah letiruah velo kulum. You should not have any break of time between tikiyah and tiruah. You should go right tikiyah, tiruah, tikiyah in one breath, right? All right together. Some of you shouldn't even say it should be one breath. Some say, okay, you can take a little breath in between. But point is, don't wait any time between them." Keman, kedibiyuda. That must follow the biyuda. He says that they're all one unit. So that's why you have to blow them all together in one breath. Because if you follow the banan, oh, they're separate things. So then, right, you can separate them. So we agree with that, except we say, idibiyuda, peshita. If you're following the biyuda, why would I have to say it? I'm going to follow the biyuda and they're one, of course you have to blow them in one breath and you can't stop in between. So why would Rav Kahana even think, bother to say the statement? No, he had to say, because I might have thought that if I followed Rabbanan, it could even be according to Rabbanan, and it's to exclude what Rabbi Yochanan said. Rabbi Yochanan said, if you hear nine blows during the day, one every hour, that's all you need, right? That's okay. You can separate an hour between each one. Tikiyah, an hour later do tiruah, an hour later do tikiyah, and you hear nine blows during the day. He says nine because that's the minimum that you would need, one for each of the three sections of Musaf. And that would be okay. Kamash malan, so that's why Rav Kahana, you might have thought Rav Kahana is coming to say, no, I don't follow Rabbi Yochanan, you can't wait an hour. But maybe you would think that you can wait a few seconds in between. And that's why he says, no, even according to Rabbanan, you should say them all together. Okay, now we ask, wait a second, maybe that is indeed the case. Maybe Rav Kahana really is following Rabbanan. And he meant to say, you can't separate by them an hour, but you can have a few seconds in between. How do you know he's really following the Biyuda all along? Imken my velo kelum. His statement said there should be no time between them, not at all. Velo kelum sounds like not even a second. Therefore, he's not following Rabbanan and telling you don't wait an hour, but it's okay a few seconds. He's saying not at all zero. That means he's following Rabbi Yehuda. Okay, halacha is in the end like Rabbanan. Nevertheless, we do have a halacha that's similar to this, which is a Shivarim Teruah, in the middle one. Wait, so let me explain why we do that. It'll take just 1 minute. That really, the letter of the law, you just have to do 9 blasts. Tikiah Teruah Teruah, Tikiah for Malchiyot, Zichronot, Shofarot. So that'll be 9 altogether. The thing is, what exactly is a Teruah? Does a Teruah sound like short weeping, or like a little bit longer, or a combination of the two? Since there's 3 different possibilities, so we do all 3. So that means for Malchiyot, we do all 3. For Zichronot, Shofarot, we do all 3. And we count the Shevarim Teruah as 2. So therefore, that in the way is 4. That line is 4. So that gives you 30 during one Amidah. That's how we end up with 30 during an Amidah. And now we do more, because at least Syrians have accustomed to blow in Nahash and in Chazara. And we don't want to wait that long to do all them, because people are talking in the middle and whatever. So we do Miyoshev, right? When you say the Beracha, we do a whole 30. So you end up having 30, 30, 30 is 90. And then we add 10 more at the end for 100. And Teruah Gedolah, you get 101. But those are all added later based on other symbolisms and Kabbalah. In the Spanish Portuguese synagogue and other places, they don't blow during the Lachash. So they're missing 30. When I was living there, my kids got this wrong on their test in Bar Kaitas. How many blows? They said, right? they said less. And that's in fact what they do. But anyway, that's the background. But the key thing is to have always long, short, and long. Rabbi Soloveitchik explained the symbolism as the short is cries and mourning and sadness, but you should never have only pure sadness. You should always have some confidence, and you come in and sandwich it with optimism and good feelings, and not focus only on negative feelings. And that's at least part of the symbolism that's encoded in the sounds of the shofar and also of the trumpets. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.